You're listening to the ESO Network, your station for all things geek.
Hey, you. Welcome to my Extended Childhood. This week we watched Speed Racer, what the Wachowskis apparently really wanted to do other than the Matrix sequels, because this, better than the Matrix sequels. It's a Technicolor nightmare of warmth and hope and John Goodman killing people. It's what you wish that Walter did in the Big Lebowski, but this time with ninjas off a 40th story of hotel room. My goodness, this movie is fun. Also, I don't know if I'm in the next Cineprov show or not. I'm moving, and this is the worst. But also, I'm tired, and this is the worst. So, go to Cineprov whether I'm there or not, because they're funny people, and sometimes they invite me to be funny with them. And if I'm not there in June, I will be there in July. Awesome. So, how's everyone doing? I hope it's awesome, and I hope you're here for us. And I hope you're here to round out the season, which is almost done. Thanks.
Here comes Speed Racer. He's a demon on wheels. He's a demon and he's gonna be chasing after someone.
Yes, yes, hello. Let's talk about the Flopcast.
Every week, we give podcast listeners a chance to come and join us in Chicken Town,
where we talk about Saturday morning cartoons, comics and science fiction conventions, music and concert reports, 70s and 80s pop culture, and for no good reason, chickens.
Boy, we're weird.
Oh, we are ridiculous.
We're proud members of the ESO Network, and you can find us at flopcast.net.
Welcome to Maybe Defend Your Childhood. This week, we watched Speed Racer, the sequel to Matrix Revolutions. I'm Nick Hoffman, host of Myopia Defend Your Childhood and riffer on Cineprov. And on panel, we have...
Hello, this is Daniel, and I'm desperately holding out for a wacky races movie.
Noted author in my own mind, Matthew W. Quinn.
I am a riffer of Cineprov and a diehard loyalist to the film Speed Racer, Evan.
This is our second-to-last movie in our animation come-to-life... whatever. This is the Wachowskis' fourth movie, I think.
Bound, The Matrix, The Matrix Revolutions, The Matrix Reloaded. Their fifth, I think.
Yeah, because this was not in between. This was post-Matrices.
Yeah. Yeah, and they produced V for Vendetta, but they didn't direct it.
Oh, correct. They didn't? Oh, I thought
right.
They did.
Nope.
No, that was...
They wrote the script and they produced it, but James McTeague directed it.
Yeah.
Because someone said, you know, this might need to be serious, kind of. And after the third Matrix movie, we're not letting you touch anything.
Why, when you look up IMDb's entry for Speed Racer, is there a still from Threads right there on the right?
Is there really?
There is. Wow. I don't know.
It's the policeman with the bandages covering his eyes.
I don't have an answer for you. Oh, it's because someone made a Matt Quinn category. Movies you should only see once.
What? I disagree.
I've seen Threads like three times.
Sorry, that person is not making statements on the show.
Isn't Threads like supposed to be super duper grimdark?
Yes.
And?
What's your point?
I mean, crawling in my skin. Right. So, before we get too far into this, I guess we should get the plot. This was 100% Evan's call.
Yeah, I love this movie so much. Honestly, one of my like top five favorite movies of all time.
This might be the reason why HD exists. This is the most beautiful film I've ever seen. This should be playing all the time in Best Buy.
And a lot of it holds up still. I mean, the movie is over 10 years old at this point, right? 2007?
Yeah. This came out the same year as Transformers, by the way.
Fun fact. So I mentioned this off mic, but this movie bombed, as we all know.
Yeah.
Because not only did it come out the same year as Transformers, but it also came out the same week as Iron Man 1.
Oh!
Right after that was the second Narnia movie, and the first one was a pretty big
Yeah.
At least the first one was.
We all need Lion Jesus in our hearts.
Exactly. Yeah. And you know what movie came out the week after that?
What?
Indiana Jones 4. So this movie had no chance.
This was a dumpster fire release.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I mean, because you could have picked any other weekend. To be fair, if you had to put money on which animated movie or animated show from the 80s that you revived into a movie form would do better, Speed Racer or Iron Man, I would have thought this.
Same, actually.
I mean, but Iron Man turned out to be an excellent movie.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's why we have the MCU.
Oh, yeah.
Right? What a gamble.
Yeah.
Let's start with Iron Man. Give him an alcoholic Robert Downey feel.
Who's that character that, like, Stan Lee literally made to prove a point that he could make an unlikable superhero? Let's start with
Ant-Man.
Yeah.
Oh.
No, literally Iron Man.
No, yeah.
Iron Man was one, he a wife beater?
He was a wife beater. He was an alcoholic. He was an arms dealer during the Cold War. Like, yeah. He was pretty despicable.
I mean, like, Ant-Man was the wife beater. I thought Tony Stark.
No, Tony. Pranked. Tony Stark really smacked around. What's her name?
Pepper Potts.
Yeah.
There's like a 6-month arc in the 90s where he's trying to detox, for Christ's
sake. Yeah, exactly.
Demon in a bottle.
Yeah,
and it's not going well.
Doesn't he end up homeless?
No, yes, he does. He ends up where
Spider-Man
Bruce Wayne should.
Beat up Mary Jane at one point.
He did.
Did he?
It's Spider-Man 3.
Oh, right. Yeah, that's true.
He throws some backhands in that movie.
While acting like a bullied nerd's idea of a cool person.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why I love that scene.
In other words, throwing finger guns?
Yeah, I absolutely. I think that scene is phenomenal.
And like humping the air.
Yeah.
In other words, he was acting like a Republican.
Oh, please.
My little finger rises. Cool.
Well, I mean, my favorite part about that scene is he thinks he's so cool, and when he walks by, all the women are just staring at him like,
right?
What the hell is wrong with
him? Total Raimi, and that's not even close to Speed Racer, but that is why that scene, at least that scene, is awesome.
Well, I mean, you want to talk about awkward sexuality? Segway.
Hey, look at you. You're the host of a podcast.
Since Evan's already going to gush all over this, Daniel, why don't you give us our plot synopsis?
Well, it's the Speed Racer plot. Speed is part of the Racer family. So that's literally his name, by the way, Speed Racer.
It's true.
Who is obsessed with car racing for some reason. His older brother was a champion driver who unfortunately died on the track.
Yep.
And as he comes of age, he starts getting attention for his racing abilities. So the guy who played Lewis Prothero in V for Vendetta owns all the Worldwide Racing Federation.
His name is like Alum or something.
Yeah, something like that. And I'm sure Evan will correct me on the name later, but he's like offering Speed a contract to be exclusive to this company. Speed says no, so the guy's like, every race is fixed. I control everything, so we're going to destroy you. So he meets up with a new crew, including the mysterious Racer X, to win some more off-the-book races and qualify for the Grand Prix. Will he win the Grand Prix?
Have you ever seen an episode of TV?
You'll just have to see.
Yeah,
I've not.
Win the Grand Prix and off-road racing, which is the most incredibly ludicrously brutal racing I've ever seen. Like, at one point, a dude pulls out a handgun and starts shooting at him.
It's so comical and great.
Which mildly annoys the commentators.
Yeah. It's like I shouldn't have that firearm.
It's like Death Race 2000 for 10-year-olds.
Basically.
Like, let's throw a beehive into someone's car.
You say that like it's a bad thing.
This movie tells you exactly what it is in the first 10 minutes.
Yeah.
And it stays right there. It's at one point, they're just casually driving down the road after Rex picks up Speed from school. And it's like a Dr. Seuss nightmare. It's Technicolor. It's glorious. And you're just like, the movie can only go downhill from there, but it doesn't. It gets better.
Not at all. Right. That CG, like outside, is the worst part about the movie for sure. Like when they're like, here's the house. It's like, that's a PlayStation 2 video game.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that's it.
And it's one of those annoying ones that you have to read all the books in the library to find the next clue.
So missed.
It's as though one of those horrible live-action Dr. Seuss movies was also missed.
Yeah. And Mike Myers is there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, no.
What are you doing in my swamp?
God, that movie's terrible.
Shrek?
No.
Cat in the Hat.
Sorry.
Yeah, Cat in the Hat's bad.
Yeah. Cat in the Hat is not good.
Yeah.
Right.
Is that a Stay Tuned?
No.
We'd have to watch it.
So I don't want to watch it.
How do you guys feel about this plot being as like pretty deep and layered. There's a lot going on.
I only watched a few episodes of the show when I was a kid, and I don't remember it being that deep of a show other than the car hater episode, the guy whose son was killed in the car accident. Sabotaging people's cars.
He pulled a gun on Speed, if I'm not mistaken.
This is like, it's like the Black Sox scandal with more murder. It's like very deep about like professional sports rigging and corporate corruption and independent artists sticking it to the man and stuff. It's really deep for a kid's movie.
Here's the thing, though. I've never watched the original cartoon, so I'll go ahead and surrender myself now. The closest I've ever gotten was that Dexter's Lab episode where they parodied Speed Racer using a soapbox derby, which was great, by the way. Oh, yeah. You should check it out.
Go Speed Dexter, go.
No, that was, I do not believe that was a line.
Well, should be.
Yeah, it should have been.
I believe that was a later episode, but we won't get into that now.
Speed Dexter, which he discovers drugs.
The thing is, the like American version of it, at least I haven't watched a ton of it, but it does seem to kind of just be a parody of itself because it is like the birth of like bad English translation. You know what I mean?
So, well, and like one frame a second. Like,
right, exactly. Yeah, it's not.
Do their lips line up when they speak, right?
They don't move. The mouth is generally open when he's talking and closed when he's not.
Like, oh, wow.
Yeah. So you get lots of thinking and, oh.
Oh. Which they do in this movie.
They do.
Oh.
I appreciate that. It totally, because it's 1 second, well, right? With
Matt said it was layered, though, that the plot was layered. And to me, it was kind of a standard kids movie. It was like the good guys need to win, the bad guys need to lose, which it's fine. It's kind of a dumb plot, they do it well, though.
On the surface, I think it's that, but you do have lots of, like, you got, like, four races, and then you have the gang stuff going on in the background, and then you...
Well, and it's a lot,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, right.
Because, like, so you could have cut out...
any one plot. Like, you could have cut out the romance with Trixie. You could have cut out the Spritel Chim Chim stuff. You could have cut out a lot of stuff, and the movie would still be intact.
Is there really a love story? It's just she's there.
Well, this is a lot of androgynous people having. Well, I mean, it's kids. It's a kids' romance, right? Like, and that's fine. And she can also drive pretty well, which Speed is kind of uncomfortable with, which is the best.
Yeah.
I mean, my other thought is, it would be great if there was just straight up sabotage, but they don't go that far. Like, if one point, like a bad mob movie, his brakes are just cut.
Yeah. Yeah.
Evil Roger Allam. Royalston, the corporate guy, at one point it wants the other racers to beat him up in the locker room.
They like run him off the road. This is the last act of this is insane.
They're trying to murder him.
There are people, I'm surprised more people don't die in this one because people are going off cliffs and exploding and crashing into each other. This is like,
well, they got those,
people die. I'm almost certainly someone is dead.
Bubble thing.
Even
right?
With that, because you only see it in a couple scenes.
And Racer X definitely, Rex Racer dies.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I see what you just did there.
Oh, by the way, Rex Racer is such a better name than Speed Racer.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I would be pissed off if my brother had a cool name and I was just Speed.
I don't know a lot of words. I'm joking.
Spraddle.
Spraddle.
Yeah, the little brother's name. Is that even a real word? Spritle?
I'm sure it's a car thing.
Like, I call him Brundle, except that brings up the fly.
His name is definitely not
Brundle. Brundle Racer?
Grundle Racer? What were you saying?
Can't call him Grundle. That's a child.
Ooh.
Grundle I believe Racer. You said Brundle Racer.
Brundle from the fly.
Right. Yeah.
So Brundle at least sounds like a name. Sprindle. What's that?
Sprindle.
And Chim Chim. Yes. What is that face?
Oh, yeah, they should have had Urban Dictionary.
I knew you ended up on Urban Dictionary. That's an Urban Dictionary face.
I just Googled what a Spritel was to see if it was like a car thing, and it's not. Nope. Oh. It's just a really awful thing.
Urban Dictionary aside, did you guys like Spritel in this movie?
No.
Well, here's the thing. This is exactly how the show works. Like, he shows up and dicks around for 10 minutes, and then the episodes make no sense anyway.
Right, absolutely.
I just remember one where... they try and break Pops out of prison with the whole, with that whole...
Because he killed the ninja.
Bake the tools in the cake. Oh. And remember, they drop the cake and the tools all spilled out. And Pops like, oh, the boy's just not a very good cook. Cut to Spritel and the chimp in the cell with Pops.
Did you just call him Spritel?
It's definitely Spritel.
Whatever. He married the chimp.
Well, you know, never know what happens in prison.
Right. So, I mean, I don't even know how to talk about this movie other than there's two parts. There's a plot, and then there's just races.
Well, I mean, visually, like, right, I think is a good way to...
Yeah, let's do this.
A cohesion in the movie. Because, like, it's very, like... This movie does something that I really like that a lot of other cartoon adaptations don't do, whereas, like, a lot of cartoon adaptations are, like, what if this, but in the real world? You know what I mean? Like, Dark Knight definitely started that.
Yeah.
Or, like, Transformers definitely does that. Lots and lots of these grittier movies, you know, are like, what if this in the real world? Whereas Speed Racer's like, what if the Speed Racer world?
No, you're right. And it actually does a good job with it, because a movie we didn't do this month but I've seen is The Flintstones. And yeah, that looks like weird, garbagey.
Also starring John Goodman.
Also with John Goodman.
Yeah.
Because they just don't know how to make it work.
Right.
Here, the CGI is just like, well, we just make cars look fancy. Because everything just looks like a concept car. You know, one of those ones that never goes into production.
But right, looks like the Homer.
Yeah,
it
the
looks
Homer,
like the
yeah.
Homer.
It says La Cucaracha when you hit the horn.
There's a separate pod for children, which is the best, like, nothing joke. But yeah, I mean, that's what it is. And then they just make everything else Technicolor in a weird way.
Yeah.
But that's how the Speed Racer world should look. It's just funny that in the real cartoon, they had like four colors at their disposal.
Right, absolutely.
Well, the big problem that we've had with the other movies we've done this month is they tried to not only apply that thinking about what if it existed in the real world, they applied cartoon logic to those movies.
Right.
So somebody would get hurt, and it's like, I don't think that's cartoon slapstick. I'm worried that that guy just got hurt.
Absolutely. But like, if you build the world around it, it's like we have a different set of rules.
And that's what this movie does very effectively.
It does it like with little things too. Like obviously the CG and like the color palette and stuff does it. But also like when Royalton, when he lays out the contract for Speed, he's like, you'll sign that contract. It's like four identical documents right next to each other, you know?
Yeah.
And like, it's that kind of thing.
Well, and it's all in the, and it's impossible to describe how much this looks like the cartoon, but when, even in that scene, it cuts to like a profile of his face gesturing aggressively as Speed is like gasping, and then they scroll across.
Yeah, they love their transitions where like someone slides across the screen.
The wipes are great.
That's what it's called, wipes, with people like physically moving across
the
screen.
And they're like telling this tragic backstory of how like the first race that we see Speed Racing is the same one that like Rex set the track record on.
Yeah.
And you just have this montage of commentators, like an English guy, an American guy who hates him, which is hilarious, a French guy, a German woman, and a Japanese woman. And it's just panning across and they're telling the same story in different languages. It's amazing. And it's looks like the cartoon, but it's impossible to describe if you haven't seen this.
Yeah, it's a visual. It's just, I do think it's a masterpiece personally, but I also think it's just, you'll not see a movie like it probably ever again. Which
That's true.
Because it lost $30 million.
Precisely.
Globally.
Yeah. Right. But it is, I mean, it does so many cool things that I think are, you know.
Well, and it's important. It's one of the few stories that I've seen where they got people who are just good actors. Because clearly the story is in most of the other ones we've done. It's like, oh, I loved the show growing up. That's why I want to be in Casper for some reason.
Yeah.
This, it was just, we get good actors, but the directors know the show inside and out.
Right.
They want it to look like the show, but better.
I'm pretty sure Emil Hirsch was a big fan of the cartoon series, and that's why he signed on.
Well, I think I have no idea.
I'm pretty sure that he said that in an interview around the time.
Well, I'm sure they all say that in interviews.
Yeah, there is that.
Tommy
but
Lee
he's
Jones.
Pretty young, so like, right. I mean, at the time, he was.
Yeah,
like,
he's probably younger than we are now.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Oh, good Lord.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this was a decade ago, so now he's an old codger.
Yeah, something I have in my notes, the acting is really good. Like, John Goodman's good as Pop. Susan Sarandon is good as the mom.
Oh, man.
And the mom, apparently, the original show didn't really have much of a point, but she's a lot more active in this one. Roger Allam as Royalston, he's good, too.
Is that the dude's name? Apparently, he played, like, Javert in Les Mis.
Yeah.
And, like, that, so just the way he, like, flips to I totally buy it, you know, just he is.
And Trixie is Christina Ricci, who I didn't know at the time. She is, seems decent.
She's good.
What was the last thing she's been in?
I have no idea.
Her funeral.
Oh, no.
No,
what?
That got dark.
Emil Hirsch is our age, or my age, I guess.
Okay. Christina Ricci, she was in 10 Things We Should Do Before We Break Up. That's,
yeah,
she was Tara in Teen Titans. Straight to DVD movie.
She wasn't Tara all the time?
Nope. She was Smurf. She was in the Smurfs 2.
Oh, gross.
Oh, God.
Black Steak Moan in 2006. Adam's Family in 91. That's not good.
Alpha and Omega. Oh, she was in Bucky Larson, Born to be a Star.
Oh, boy.
One of the worst movies of all time.
The Lizzie Borden Chronicles. as Lizzie Borden.
Good casting. Yeah. I'm actually going to say.
She's a good actress. I don't know how she's not getting more.
Well, yeah, what killed her career? Bucky Larson, maybe.
Probably. I feel like Speed Racer back-to-back with Bucky Larson just did Jan. You can't. I mean.
She voiced herself in the video game version of Speed Racer.
Which I did not play.
I'm shocked. I'm actually surprised at that.
I didn't play the video game?
I'm not.
On the PlayStation 2?
Everyone. Wow. They got like everyone to voice themselves.
Good on them.
Looks like John Goodman. I'm not seeing John Goodman.
You're saying John Goodman was too busy to be in a video game?
Has John Goodman been in a video game?
Yeah, he voiced Donkey Kong in Smash Brothers.
Actually, I would love live action Donkey Kong if John Goodman played live action Donkey Kong.
Is John Goodman still alive?
Yes. He was in like six things this year.
He was Rex Tillerson on Saturday Night Live before Rex Tillerson quit.
Oh, yeah.
He was, I would totally play like a point and click adventure game.
I thought he was the guy from 10 Simple Rules who died halfway through the show.
That's John Ritter.
Oh.
I'm sorry, I really want to hear where the rest of this goes.
Yeah, I was saying I would play a point and click adventure game based on The Big Lebowski. I can get you a toe, dude. Would you like a toe?
Point and click and throw a bowling ball. That could be fun.
Bowling ball. Use bowling ball.
The dude never bowls, though, so there would be no such mission.
It looks like 1998 version of Leisure Suit Larry.
Yeah, that's
no. that's a name I haven't heard in a long, long time.
I'm thinking
Leisure
like,
Suit Larry?
Yeah.
That like 32-bit. First of all, where's our Leisure Suit Larry live action movie?
Oh my god!
it's probably on a scrambled channel.
Yeah, true. No, I was picturing like compressed. You know, like it's like they used real life graphics and then just compressed it down super hard so you could like
like Mortal Kombat.
Yeah, right. Exactly. And it's a point and click.
So who's playing Leisure Suit Larry? I have it. Ooh. I have the casting. Because like the whole point of the games is that he's a loser that charms the women. Yeah. So I'm thinking Paul Giamatti.
I was thinking younger. I was thinking like Jay Baruchel or Christopher Mintz Plotz.
Yeah, no, you're right. Like, because we got to young it up a little bit.
Yeah,
like
a little
bit. 50-year-old Paul Giamatti, like, oh man, why can't I get with any of these women? Oh, jeez.
I'm picturing Channing Tatum in a fat suit and a bald wig.
Yeah, actually, when are we getting our Channing Tatum in a fat suit movie? We are due.
Well, it's like when
tweet this episode at Channing Tatum's Twitter account, see what happens.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
Probably a block.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's like when Benicio del Toro played the fat guy in Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas.
Yeah,
right. It's just like you have to take one of the most attractive men in Hollywood, and make him gain 75 pounds, and just kind of pudge around.
And that's how you get nominated for Oscars, people.
If we've learned anything from Vice, which we haven't. Trust me, we have not. That train wreck.
Well, speaking of Vice, a very, very similar question as to Vice. Who is this movie for?
Well, 93 million people figured it out. Well, the rest did not.
Yeah.
I think it would be for kids. I mean, it's violent, but not like you see someone's head getting cut off and blood going everywhere.
True.
It's goofy and cartoonish.
It was marketed heavily towards kids back when it was first released.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm pretty sure it was a PG movie.
But yeah, it was PG.
That's why I think that Transformers had, and Iron Man had that success, is that it was a kid's movie, but it also was very not like for like parent. And I could be speaking of turn here. Nick, you're a parent. You can say your kid's got to watch a lot of stuff, right?
Yeah.
Would you rather take them to something that may not be the most appropriate, but is still probably just superheroes? You know, how bad can Iron Man be? It's a superhero movie, but I'm going to enjoy it too. Yeah. Or would you rather take them to Smurfs? You know what I mean?
No, I'm with you. And I think Iron Man did better because it could get a wider audience.
Right.
That's for sure. The problem with a movie like this is not that it would look better on the theater screen, of course, but if I'm a parent who just wants to get their kid in front of a movie, I'm going to rent this. I'm not going to see it in theaters.
Yeah. Right.
And that's probably also the problem, because there's nothing here for the adults, really. It's a perfectly fine movie.
I don't know if I agree with that. I would say that like if you're watching a trailer, I could see seeing nothing for an adult. Watching the movie, I think there's plenty, but yeah. I think like it gives adults no reason to want to watch it.
Yeah, I mean, especially like if it's, I don't know where you cut, but I think you cut one of the 9 races in this.
Probably.
But it's at 2 hours and 15 minutes. I don't even think it's for kids.
No, it's longer than 2:15,
well,
isn't it?
I mean, it's
cut the credits out. It's like 2:08.
That's too long for a kid's movie. A kid's movie needs to be between 90 and 100 minutes.
It's very, very
there's
long.
Literally a scene where the Louis Prothero guy, who was also Javert, which I read the
Royalston.
I read the worst dad joke about Javert earlier, which I may share later, but he Ooh. Like describes, okay, if you refuse to sign this contract at your next raise, this is going to happen. And yeah. they go through that
oh,
raise.
Oh, that's so good.
It's good, but then they turn it. Around and
then they do it anyway.
The, yeah, they no, repeat the same race.
Yeah, that's true. I do like that that scene though, because it's pretty cool.
Or the
like,
scene where maybe where Racer and Speed and Trixie are sitting out in their car, and it turns out little brother and the monkey are in the trunk. What was the point of that scene? They're not having relationship problems at any other time in the movie.
Well, it was to establish that
their
sex
that
exists in this world.
Funny monkey. Yeah,
oh,
we
and
had
Chim
said
Chim
that
hides in the trunk. That's why that scene exists.
Oh, it's foreshadowing.
Yeah, and that's kind of their only bit in the show too. That they're just pervs eavesdropping on sex scenes.
Yeah, it's and they're so weird because they definitely they're like Jar Jar, right? It's like, oh, this guy's for kids, but. Mm-hmm. But also it doesn't really fit with the movie at all. You
what
know?
Was that scene where he's like riding through a factory and like air guitaring the Freebird riff
that
with
is
Chim Chim?
My least favorite part of the movie, I think.
That's a weird scene. So yeah. apparently they get stoned out on candy. The whole thing is Royalton is wining and dining the Racer family in an effort to get Speed to sign. It's essentially a plot that they steal for Cars 2. And there's
is that the plot Cars 2? I didn't see Cars 2.
He also
Mater
mooches
becomes
off
a
their
spy.
He also mooches off their pancakes.
Who? He does.
Royalson
oh, yeah.
comes in, he starts chatting with him. They're like, oh, are those Christ. Pancakes?
No, that's great. I think he is so just delightfully like slimy, you know, like, oh he my is. God, these pancakes are amazing.
Charm the mom.
Yeah, like, absolutely. It's like, you are the best sleazy sleazebag.
I mean, and that's the thing. You just have to pick which movie you want to make. Do you want to make the Royalton, like, trying to seduce them mafia movie? Mm-hmm. Do you want to show Racer X versus Speed stuff? Which is fine. It's just a little bit too much of everything
right,
for this
I
movie.
I completely agree. Because then, again, going back to, you've got the romance. You have five races. You have... Yeah. You have all the family drama. You have
the plastic surgery involving Racer X.
Right, which...
Hey,
whoa.
Spoilers, man.
We're 20 minutes in. We can talk about spoilers. We're 25 minutes in.
I feel like if people are listening to this, they're
okay,
not
they
like,
keep jacking us around about whether Racer X is his brother who they thought was dead or not.
That was sequel bait is what that was, I think, to a sequel that never got made.
Not even close to being made.
Now, yeah. What was the point of Racer X in the cartoon?
He's that. I mean, literally every time he comes on screen, what Speed doesn't know is that Racer X is his brother who secretly died in the race. Oh, like, and then you cut.
Racer X makes a lot of sense as a character because he's someone that Speed can, you know, prescribe to try and be. That's his goal is Racer X, or Rex Racer, rather.
Yeah.
So he works as a character. This whole thing of we're going to pull all the rug out from the audience at the last moment is like,
well,
why?
And the thing we get at the like middle of the third act where they reveal that it actually is like Rex Racer and he just had plastic surgery should have been done in the first act so that the people who know the show, again, if you're watching this movie, you know the show.
Right.
And then your kids maybe don't, but you know the show. Get it done within the first act.
It's also pretty well established that it's like, this is your brother. His
yeah.
name is Racer X. You
right,
know?
Like the plastic surgery thing, I guess, fine, who cares? But just reveal it in the first act. It doesn't add anything. It just adds 20 minutes to this movie.
Yeah,
it doesn't need 20 minutes added.
I like it as a standalone moment, but again, it's just one of those things that you can just trim and snip some of the fat away at this movie.
Well, and we haven't gotten to it, but like there's this whole thing called, is it the CDI? Who's this? The spy agent?
Oh,
or the detective agency?
Yeah,
Inspector
again.
Detector?
Oh, yeah.
Detective.
Inspector Detector, yeah.
And so there's someone, there are people investigating this cartel of racers who are like scheduling the race. And
right. Going back to it,
they're
complex movie.
They're fixing races to affect their company's stock prices
mm-hmm.
for financial purposes that I can't really explain right now.
They're trying to, you know,
well, there's
everything.
Like, yeah. They're putting a bunch of futures on the stock to go up or down based on who wins the race, and then they're rigging the races
so
that's
it.
Outcome happens. At least that's what I thought was going on.
Yeah.
It becomes like The Big Short for about 10 minutes,
yeah,
which is
weird.
Yeah,
a little bit.
The Big
like,
Short with auto racing and less nudity.
If it was a cartoon. Yeah, with less nudity.
Well, The Big Short kind of is a cartoon.
It's true.
Can you imagine an anime? It's like a Schoolhouse Rock video.
Yeah.
This is how collusion works.
That's a lot of what it was, except instead of like catchy tunes, you had naked Margot Robbie explaining things.
In a bathtub.
In a bathtub. Mm-hmm. It was awesome. Mm.
This is how Game of Thrones gets exposition.
Yeah,
man.
It
Let's
is.
Figure shit out.
And it's genius.
It's good. Yeah. It is. The first couple races, it's Speed wanting to be like his brother Rex, which is literally just Racer, family, X.
And it even sounds like his name.
Yeah, it does.
Racer, comma, Rex.
Hiding in plain sight.
Yeah, exactly. Sure. Inspector Detective is investigating the whole time. He turns down Royalton. And then we have some races where he's getting shoved. He's like, hey, buddy, you going to sign up with us? Shove.
Yeah, that's where it gets really muddy. You have the Fuji race, and then you have the, oh, God, what's
the cross-country death derby.
The desert race.
The Casa.
Oh, God, what's it called?
It's actually the name of a real racetrack. Yeah.
It is the Casa Cristo 5000.
Yeah, the Casa Cristo. That's it.
And the Casa Cristo.
The Count of Casa Cristo?
Yeah. Well, but the Casa sandwich. Cristo, they sign up for because they needed to qualify for the Derby. Right. Or the Grand Prix,
rather. The Grand Prix, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it just so happens to be the one that killed Racer X, or Rex Racer.
Right, right. So you could just make Fuji the race that killed. Or no, Fuji's the one that killed Rex Racer, right? Because it was the mountain one?
No, that's Casa Cristo.
No, yeah.
Whatever. Sure. It's
no, Fuji's the one where they team up.
Yes.
You know, there is one thing that surprises me about all this is auto racing is the thing that's holding this world together. Like, it's the thing everybody watches. It's right. The thing everyone pays attention to. But there's never, like, a moment, or, like, very few moments, at least, where the auto drivers become big celebrities. You get a couple moments of, like, post-race interviews, which are great.
Yeah.
But I just would have liked it if there was, like, a main racer who was, like, on cereal boxes or something.
Yeah. I think they kind of touch on that when he talks about, like, again, when he's initially offering the contract.
Yeah, I mean, but then there's this whole plot that picks up here with Toka Gon, the actor's is just named Rain. So giving him two names is more than he had to begin with.
And trying to feed people to piranhas.
Oh, God. On the back of a truck.
Yes.
Well, we're mobile.
Get rid of it entirely.
Hey, your mobile.
No, keep it. Are you kidding me? Keep that. That's the best.
Well, hey, if you want to have your evil supervillain lair and torture chamber, but no one can find it, having it mobile.
Hey, law enforcement can't raid a place with no fixed address.
Right.
Oh, that's a good one. Pretty smart.
Good point.
And I love Racer X just kind of bumping him on the road. That's incredible.
Something I really like about this movie is like a lot of the action, like all that we talk bumping, you know, but it's all very well choreographed.
Yeah.
Which, you know. Movies around this era, we're still trying to figure out how to incorporate CG into action. For instance, I think a lot of the fights in Transformers look pretty sloppy because you can't really tell what's going on.
Yeah, there's a lot of blur.
Right, but the way that this movie uses like kind of its jump cuts and the way it like the shots go between racers and stuff and cars, I think it's very well laid out what's happening despite how fast it is. On top of that, I think it also does a really great job of establishing like the speed of it, you know, like they have a great use of speed lines, which are pretty non-traditional, I would say, with establishing movement in movies and stuff.
You know what the greatest animated moment is? It's that fist fight that the Racer family has with those assassins in the snow.
Where the snow becomes the speed. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, it's like the Matrix.
I wonder why.
Yeah, no kidding.
And Sparky is just useless.
Well, it's kind of like Scott Pilgrim, right? Like Scott Pilgrim gets credit for that a lot.
Yeah, but it does.
Like, no, they beat Scott Pilgrim by like 5 years.
Yeah. It's a cool integration of all the layers of how it looks. Mm-hmm. Like, because you're right that the way the cars kind of fly together is neat, but the cars are distinct.
Yeah.
You can actually tell who's who. Mm-hmm. I mean, to Daniel's point earlier, like Wacky Races, the racers look distinct.
Yeah, true. Yeah. Their costume design in that movie is impeccable. I mean, like Snake Oiler looks like Snake Oiler, like a guy named Snake Oiler.
Yeah. The Viking guys in the second to last race are incredible. There's three of them. There's like Broomhilda.
Yeah.
Those guys are amazing. Again, Wacky Racers, do it. But this is also why it costs $120 million a decade ago. This costs more than some of the Star Wars movies that have come out.
Yep.
Oh, is that true?
Yeah.
No. That can't be right.
Well, the first prequel was like $100 million.
Wow.
Yeah. I mean, and that's what sunk it, right? If it cost
$60 million.
It also wouldn't have looked like this.
It's true. It couldn't have.
I hope this gets enough of a cult following that they can do something like this again, because their other movies have just been so... Encourage this. This is what, like, the problem with Jupiter Ascending is not, well, other than Eddie Redmayne having a little hissy fit.
Well, isn't Channing Tatum a bee in that movie?
He's a dogman.
He's a dogman.
He is, in fact, a
bee. There's a line, bees can sense royalty, which I like that movie, even I thought that was bad.
Yeah. There's a lot bad with that movie.
Yeah.
I think you're one of the few people I've met that admits to liking it.
I mean, to me, the thing about it is this is as cartoony as it should be, go with it.
Yeah.
I would let them adapt so many more Hanna-Barbera things if this is what it was going to be.
Anything. Well, apparently people are calling Alita Battle Angel the new Speed Racer.
It was a compliment or a warning?
I think it's a compliment, potentially a warning. But it's just saying visually, you know, it is an anime adaptation, but it's not afraid of its, like, where it comes from.
Right.
You know,
well, now we have the China market, so any movie that doesn't do well here will make $1 billion over there.
Like Pacific Rim 2, which is not a good movie.
Or Warcraft.
Or Warcraft. Oh, Warcraft. Warcraft did very well overseas, if I'm not mistaken.
And it bombed
very
well. Here.
And it looked great. I saw it.
Ellipses.
Yeah.
It looked great. Hey.
I thought it was fun.
I'm sure you did. All the bad movies we've mentioned so far, you've been like, I liked it. I'm like, okay.
So that's why I'm here.
Yeah, exactly right. I would say at the end of the day, though, this movie's plot doesn't matter. I mean, John Goodman beats a ninja to death and then throws him out of a window.
Yeah, more like exactly. A ninja.
Ninja, that's, more like a ninja.
That is, I'll give this with that. That is one of the most thoroughly joyful scenes in this movie when, you know, Pops Racer just comes in and goes full blown, like, you know, Greco-Roman on a ninja.
Well, they show the great championship ring that he has from wrestling.
Yep. Which, weird, but he suplexes and then tosses a ninja out of a window that was trying to murder his family, and he just leaves now. That's great, because the ninja is defeated, right? We don't need to worry about that logic.
Deus Ex Chim Chim, I guess.
It could have been more with Chim Chim, because chimps are really nasty, aggressive creatures. Have the fight scene in the mountain pass, Chim Chim just bites someone in the crotch.
Tears his face off? I don't know.
Bites an arm off?
Yep.
For one scene, it becomes like David Lynch's Speed Racer. It all turns to gray, and he just tears a face off.
Why are you wanting me to direct your Speed Racer movie there?
It's Frank Miller from Sin City. Just
I'm the goddamn Chim Chim.
God, I would go broke the amount of times I saw that movie in theaters.
Oh, God.
Goodness. It's just really close up. You can see, like, the scars on Chim Chim's face as he's just tearing this man's
face. And, of course, Trixie's not wearing a shirt, just bandages.
Yeah, right.
And it does the close up on John Goodman's eyes. It says, more like a ninja.
Oh, God. Why does this thing not exist? This needs to exist.
To be fair, this movie shouldn't exist at all.
No.
I think, again, huge money sink.
Just because it failed doesn't mean it shouldn't have existed. They just picked a bad week to release it. Well, this was a cheerful, joyful, fun movie.
Again, one of my top five favorite movies of all time, no doubt. It's a great, I mean, it's a little bloated, but other than that, I mean, it's a wonderful, like, opera, basically, about racing. And, like, it's got a great hero's journey, and there's a lot of heart to it, like that scene where, you know, he's like, you remember that night, Speed? You and me stayed up all night, and we watched that race. And and they later find out it's rigged. It's amazing.
Well, this is what that's like. It doesn't matter if it's rigged. They're good racers. And, like, the one black guy who's the racer, whose name I forget, he just, like, looks away ashamed at one point, it's kind of great.
But then you see him rooting for Speed, because Speed stuck to his guns, which this guy did not. Again, it's all these people kind of above Speed showing him the path he can take.
No.
And he forges his own.
No.
One of the greatest stylistic moments in this movie is that bit where Speed and Trixie are racing together on the same team because that one guy got poisoned by the ninja.
Yep. Yeah.
They're both talking, but instead of, like, cutting to them, it'll, like, the camera will zoom in onto Speed. He says his line, it'll zoom out.
Whips back. Right, absolutely.
Whips back into Trixie. She says her line and just keeps doing that. Mm-hmm. That shouldn't work, but that was so charming.
It's so good. Well, again, it helps place people on a track, right? It helps show, like, positioning and stuff.
Well,
because, or else you get lost, like, in the pod racing scene, I think you do. Because you don't really have a good sense of, like, what was the layout of that, you know? Like,
and other than they established Sebulba as a kind of a dick, nothing else is established. Here you establish everyone fairly well.
Yeah, absolutely.
I also just want to point out for 2 seconds, the ninjas are amazing and terrible, right? Because essentially, they try to kill the racers or impair. They don't kill them. They, like, make them, like,
they want
to
drug them.
They drug them.
Logic. Yeah. Right? No one's trying to kill people here.
Well, but one of them is the son of the guy who's trying to buy the company from, so killing him would be probably a stupid idea.
Well, right. But they do the same thing that they do in the Bond movie, You Only Live Twice, where they run a rope down and they drip. Yeah. And I was just like, really? You're doing that?
No, it's great.
It is.
And they're dressed like, you know, the Party City Ninja. Yeah. Absolutely.
They're the cheapest costumes in the movie.
Great.
It is.
That's very clearly a ninja. And that's what this movie does well.
Well,
how else do you think Roy Royalston went from being in foster care to being so rich, he was being really, he got used economy ninjas.
Mm-hmm. It's Royalston, man. But I will say the funniest part of that whole montage to me is they get Tokugan, but Racer X has a full-out fucking fight scene. Like, it's balls to the wall. He's throwing him around.
Yeah.
And then the next room over, it's a cartoon fight scene. Same quality ninja, theoretically, but this is what happens when you have a chimp and John Goodman.
Yeah, they're, like, doing the stooges, you know, like, like poking him in the eyes and stuff.
Oh,
like,
yeah, that's right.
Yeah, it's very...
Well, and Mama Sarandon wakes up and Trixie wakes up and then just like gasp. And John Goodman is just, he's doing like Robert De Niro kicks, just like throwing this man through the wall. It's phenomenal.
Yeah, big fan.
Yeah, that was one of my favorite scenes in this movie.
I mean, the rest of it, I would play a Speed Racer game rendered in 4X in a second, just a racing game. Like, you can't play as Speed. You can play as anyone else, mm-hmm. and it looks like Mega Race or one of those 90s Technicolor games, you know?
Oh, yeah.
It's gorgeous. Mm-hmm. This movie is beautiful. This would be the perfect kind of thing to throw on in the background of a party.
Yeah.
Because it's just beautiful, it's bright,
looks
it's
good,
vivid.
Right? Yeah.
And the music, like, they should do like a Criterion release where you can turn off the dialogue and just play the music, because the music is good in this too.
Yeah. It's really good.
What? Yeah. I think, you know, visual wise, something that, like, kind of an awkward transition, but something I really wanted to touch on is when he finishes the race and, like, the whole movie is just oozing in lots and lots of different colors, but when he, like, finally skids and lands, it just becomes that red and white checkerboard.
Yep.
And I think that's awesome, because it's like, we are stripping this away to show, like, a bookend of the movie, you know? Like, yeah. I love it so much.
And he jumps out of the car. He does the famous pose where he throws the one arm up. Woo! And he's kind of half crossing his legs.
Yep.
And that's it. It cuts to the victory circle. It cuts to his family cheering. And then we get credits, man. It's just, you end this movie exactly how it needs to end. It's just 20 minutes too long.
He blows past the Racer X or Rex Racer record. Like,
Royalton. There's a bunch of tabloid headlines about him getting indicted and going to prison.
Yeah.
You wrap it up.
Was it some fuel thing? God, I just watched this movie. That was what it was.
I mean, it was probably race fixing.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Well, that's
sure
what
it was.
But there was, he like went broke because of the race too.
Well, because there's a thing called, is it the sky hook or the spike?
The spear thingy, which, considering every other weapon they use on each other gleefully.
He's cheating.
Yeah. Why is this cheating?
I don't know why this one in particular is cheating, but they do this weird, again, it's like playing a Nintendo 64 game, or like Rush 2 or something.
It's a Hot Wheels Nintendo 64.
That's exactly what it is. This might as well be a Lego movie.
Yeah,
But he hits a weird like bank, and then it flashes the camera, so you can see the spike underneath attaching the cars together, mm-hmm. and that's what sinks Royalton's stock.
Yeah.
So I have to ask, do you think blue shells would be legal in the Speed Racer world?
Oh,
everything else is.
I think it depends on the race. Like, I think, like, so they're on the actual track for that one, and they're far more forgiving, but then you have the, like, desert, you know, and they're like, whatever.
That actually, you know what, you're
so
digging around. This looks like that one in particular looks like a Mario Kart level. You go through the desert, you end up in a palace.
They all look like Mario Kart level. It's kind of a Mario Kart. It takes that, like, sense of fun and weirdness. I guarantee there's some inspiration there.
Speed Racer versus Mario Kart.
Ooh. I mean, sold.
I mean, if Mortal Kombat can have Freddy Krueger in it, then why not?
Why not? Yeah, exactly.
How is that not a Robot Chicken sketch at this point?
I think it came from Robot
Fatality,
Chicken.
Fatality, bitch!
I believe there was indeed a race sketch in Robot Chicken where it was like Speed Racer versus them Duke boys versus whoever Vin Diesel plays in Fast and Furious.
That's kind of perfect. You want to do Final Judgments? I think we talked about this.
Yeah, Final Judgments.
Danny boy, you're first.
It's too long, and despite what some other people thought, I thought the plot was too simplistic. It really is just a kiddie movie that really wraps everything into neat a bow, but that's in the spirit of the show, I guess. Mm. Of all the movies we've done this month, including Mr. Magoo, this is the only one that A, I actually liked, and B, that I want to watch again. I think it got a really bad rap when it opened up originally in 2008, and I think hopefully it's got a cult following now, and if it doesn't, it needs to have one.
Yeah. Got at least one.
Yeah,
right. I think it does have a cult following.
A cage cult.
Yeah, hey, yo.
Yeah, plug. Matt? Yeah,
true, thank you.
I don't know if I'd see it again anytime soon, but it's joyful, it's fun, it's colorful. I think it's pretty good, and I didn't expect to like it this much.
Yeah. Evan?
I love this movie. I think the plot is simple, but it's like nine simple plots on top of each other. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because I'm not disagreeing that it's simple, but I think this movie is amazing, and I think it holds up on a rewatch, and I really hope there are more movies like it, because really it's like a Wes Anderson action movie.
Yeah.
Kind of.
Oh, that's a good characterization of it. Yeah.
Yeah.
My final thoughts is pretty much the same with everyone said. I like this movie. I'd put it on again. I don't know if I'd watch the whole thing in a single sitting for a while.
Anytime soon. Yeah, it's long.
It's too long. Otherwise, I think it's perfectly fine. I think the plot is... The problem, I think, is not to argue with Daniel. It's just they couldn't pick one.
Right. Absolutely.
They focus on one. It's fine. Otherwise... Watch it. It's good. It's fun. If you can find it, it's actually harder to find than I thought.
Yeah. Well, it wasn't
on Amazon. I got it on YouTube.
Yeah. Oh, it's on YouTube?
I got it on Vudu for $2.
I just own it.
I'm sure you do.
I do.
Well, it was on YouTube that you could buy. It wasn't like a freebie.
Yeah. I mean, this needs to be a 4K Blu-ray release, because this would be glorious on like a really big screen. Yeah. It's just... This movie is pure fun. It's just 20 minutes too long to be what it wants to be.
Agreed.
But otherwise, I give them $100 million to do a season of a TV show, and I'd keep it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because in 20-minute chunks, this would be amazing.
Yeah, I totally
or 40, agree. 40-minute chunks. Hell, whatever.
Yeah. Like a Netflix series, you know? Yeah, absolutely.
And just scrape together the graphics you had before, because a decade or 11 years now, later, yeah. It looks fine.
Yeah,
absolutely. It really does.
Well, and again, a lot of that is, I think, less the, like, we have the best CG. I mean, now at the time, but a lot of it is because, you know, the artistic choices, the color palette, there are some practical effects in there. You know, all the things that make CG stuff hold up.
Yeah.
Is why it held up.
And then that's clearly where they put the money, in the right place.
Yeah, exactly.
Anyway, so this is our second to last movie this season. Next week, we're going to wrap up this season. So stay tuned next week and every future week when we put your bit of your past on trial. Thanks, guys.
He's a demon on wheels. He's a demon and he's gonna be chasing after someone.
Hey everyone, I've been asked to unpack my recording gear and re-record the credits one last time before moving. Myopia Defend Your Childhood is brought to you by the ESO Network. It is produced and assembled by Dude Letter Podcast. Your host is Nick Hoffman. Your editors are Ann Burns and Daniel Sutter. The creative team behind all this is Matt Quinn, Daniel Sutter, and Nick Hoffman. The theme song is Surf Shimmy by Kevin MacLeod. You can find his music in comptech.com. Everything we do for you guys. So rate, review, find us on iTunes, Facebook, Twitter, Letterboxd, and send us reviews, because it's the best. It makes my day every time I see a new one, a new fan, and we get you guys all the time. So help me overwhelm this sense of dread dealing with mortgages and stuff. And finally, we do this for you. So stay tuned next week and every future week when we put a piece of your past on trial. Thanks, guys.
This has been a broadcast of the ESO Network. Be part of the crew and help support our shows by donating to our ESO Patreon or by shopping through Amazon.com or the TeePublic store, which can all be found at www.esonetwork.com. The ESO Network, your station for all things geek.